Hello and welcome. Thank you for joining us. Joining me, Michael Scott in Oxford, UK, and Sanford J. Ungar in Washington, DC, to the 38th jointly promoted event between the Future of the Humanities Project and the Free Speech Project. The latter is sponsored by Georgetown University and the former by Georgetown's Humanities Initiative in association with Campion Hall, Oxford, and the Las Casas Institute for Social Justice at Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. Together, the two projects consider issues concerning human dignity, rights, cultures, histories, traditions, and freedoms in a wide spectrum of educational activity, policy, expression, and aspiration. In a moment, I'll hand over to Sandy, who is the director of the Free Speech Project. He will introduce today's distinguished guests and moderate the ensuing discussion before I return to chair the question and answer session in about 40 minutes' time. From the start, you can type in questions to the panel by using the Q and A button at the bottom of your screen. Please use the Q and A button and not the chat button. These questions will come to me during the session, and I will try and put them to the panel to consider when I come back on. We urge you to ask questions as and when they occur to you so that we don't get a bottleneck and that some people miss out at the end. Now, I'm looking forward to this very important discussion today. Over to you, Sandy.
Thank you very much, Mike Scott. We have two mics with us today, Mike Scott and Michael Sachs. Mike Sachs. I'm very happy to be continuing this series with my partner, Mike Scott, and to be returning to the issue of refugees, which we have discussed previously. And I'm sorry to say the problem appears to have become ever more complicated and difficult in the meantime. Our panelists today include Barnabas Asprey, who is from the United Kingdom but currently an assistant professor at St. Mary's Seminary and University in Baltimore, not far here from Washington. And he is particularly interested in the way that Christian belief and practice interact with contemporary Western society and its problems, including that of refugees. Catherine Donato is the Donald G. Hertzberg Professor at Georgetown University and former director of the well-regarded Institute for the Study of International Migration in the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown, a very important institute which is a source of great knowledge on this subject. Rachel Cronick, coming to us from Montreal, is a clinician scientist based at the Sherpa and Lady Davis Research Institutes there, and she is affiliated with McGill University, particularly interested in immigration policy and its consequences for children and families. And Mike Sachs, emeritus professor at the University of Suffolk in the UK, currently chairs the United Nations endorsed Institute for Responsible Leadership and has made a big point of being concerned about the educational opportunities and conditions for refugees and, of course, particularly the children amongst them. I'd like to go to Catherine first to give us a little bit of a historical perspective on just how severe the situation is today and how it got just as bad as it has. Catherine, thank you.
Thank you, and thank you for the invitation to be here. Thank you to everyone who is attending. The situation, I don't know if I could cover this in 5 minutes, but I will do my best to lay out the context, the contemporary context. In terms of the last century, a century and a half, we've never been at a record high, as high as the numbers are currently of refugees and asylum seekers, people who are on the move and searching for protection. And those numbers are at record high. More than 110 million is the number counted and published by the UN Agency for Refugees, UNHCR. But what we know is that there are often more people And that those numbers are typically underestimates. Just to give you some highlights of what right now the situation is around the world in different regions, we have more than 6 million people displaced, some of them internationally, some of them internally, as a result of the conflict that began in April 2023 in Sudan. We have more than 7 million Venezuelans who have left Venezuela, many of them is living in countries in South America, but as we know, many are making them their are heading northward, attempting to come into the U.S. We have more than 7 million Ukrainians who are living in the EU, and another more than 3 million Ukrainians who have been internally displaced as a result of that war. We have, you know, a variety of other, you know, obviously we have millions, estimates suggest about 2 million Palestinians who have been displaced as a result of the Israeli war. I mean, those are the biggest numbers, but then we still have, you know, 700,000, 800,000 Rohingya living in Bangladesh, having left most of them in the summer of 2017. And, you know, we have certainly smaller, but still very large groups of people who have been displaced around the world. Those people, individuals, as well as their families, are suffering huge hardships. And estimates suggest that these numbers haven't been as high post-World War II compared to what they were immediately after World War II. So we are in record territory here, and we seem to, at least in the last decade to two decades, been in a situation where more and more people are experiencing, at minimum, generalized violence and conditions related to violence that threaten them. Some of them are individually persecuted and would meet the international legal standard for refugee, but many others may not technically meet that legal standard, but nonetheless are searching for the same kind of protection. So we're at historically high rates and a lot of diversity around the world, with regional diversity in terms of areas experiencing large-scale displacement. The situation couldn't be more dire for as many people as we're looking at now.
Mike Sachs, thank you, Catherine, very much. That's a pretty bleak picture that Catherine draws, and your involvement with the United Nations, I presume, gives you some insight into how international organizations are dealing with this and what the strands of hope might be that would be out there to educate people, to give them a decent life, to return them to some kind of dignity and respect and humanity, despite their situation. Please remember to unmute yourself. You're on mute, Mike.
Yeah, thank you. Well, I don't represent the UN directly. Yeah, I do obviously head up one of its organizations in terms of the Institute for Responsible Leadership. And I think the UN has increasingly taken a responsible leadership stance on this, and particularly the organization that Catherine refers to, the UN HCR, which is the High Commission for Refugees, which is otherwise known as the Refugee Agency of the UN, which is based in Geneva, which is one of the biggest of the organizations that exists under the UN auspices. And this organization does take a lot of care holistically for dealing with the plight of refugees in terms of coordination and also in terms of delivery. And as we've seen in Gaza, for instance, this may sometimes be frustrated by particular political policies, which prevent access to specific areas. But nonetheless, the intention is there. And I would say that from recent observations, the Secretary General of the UN, Antonio Guterres, has actually said some very positive things about the need to not only support but show solidarity with refugees, particularly in the light of some of the dire circumstances that Catherine has begun to sketch out. This applies, you know, to everything from health right through to issues about children and their particular problems with education. And I would just say something which is a bit of a touchstone for me in terms of the Institute for Responsible Leadership. A lot of this can be traced back to the Sustainable Development Goals, which exist, the 17 goals, which relate to the need for equality, for peace, you know, for providing equality of education, for providing high quality services across the whole world in terms of moving forward. These are quite idealistic at one level, but they do act as a kind of driver to take us forward. And so that will be my opening comment from the viewpoint of the UN. I think the UN is generally a force for the good, but that doesn't mean to say that everything it wants to do actually can occur because of maybe the interests of certain countries and so on, and the way in which these can lead to some cross swords, as it were, and some vacillation in terms of dealing with what is currently a major crisis situation.
Thanks, Mike. Rachel, your particular concern and the intersection with this issue has to do with, I think, the emotional and psychological impacts of being in refugee status, and particularly for families and children, and with such numbers, such overwhelming numbers now, what do you see as the prospects for improvement?
Mm-hmm. Well, firstly, indeed, as Catherine pointed out, the numbers are at an all-time high. And we have to keep in mind that there's no prediction that numbers will decrease. And if anything, due to the climate crisis, we are likely to see unimaginable, unprecedented numbers of forcibly displaced people, whether due to climate crisis or ongoing conflict. So in that sense, the picture is bleak. But when we actually look from the perspective of mental health and people's capacity for integration, resilience, and recovery, there is a great deal to be optimistic about. Because what we know is that despite people's exposure to horrific trauma, that the majority of forcibly displaced people, particularly refugees who are granted protection, do very well. That it is a small minority who carry a significant burden of mental health problem, despite everything they've been exposed to. But what we're learning as mental health research makes advances is that what they experience in the host country, the country they land in, whether it be the United Kingdom or Canada or the United States, what happens to them there is a very significant determinant of their mental health and trajectory for integration. So when we, I would use the word vulnerabilize, when host nations vulnerabilize children and their parents, for example, by keeping them in limbo, not granting them security that they can count on for a long period of time, this we can see increases mental health burden. And then, of course, with mental health burden comes all the difficulties of integration, which come with all the economic difficulties. So in other words, I'm saying when we have hospitable, welcoming reception practices, the so-called crisis of refugee arrivals can really be mitigated. People, in fact, integrate, find jobs, etc. But unfortunately, we tend to discursively frame refugees and asylum seekers and forcibly displaced people as the crisis themselves and potential burdens on our economies and school systems, et cetera, et cetera. And I think we need to work on a reframing. I'm not an economist, but the economic studies I know that have been done have actually shown refugees and asylum seekers are tend to contribute more than they take in any host society context. So yes, we need to be attentive to the alarming numbers, but we also have to keep in mind that this need not be a crisis if we respond in the appropriate ways, because people can do very well.
Thank you for that. I think nice to have some optimism lurking in the shadows. Barney, your focus is on religious issues, and I wonder if you can speak for a moment about how the developed world has allowed this to happen. What are the morals and the ethics of this situation, and whom can we count upon to respond to it?
Well, I mean, I think anybody who ignores the role that religion plays in this whole crisis is never going to really understand it, or they might misunderstand it, because religion is very much at the root of a lot of what goes on with regard to policies about who is accepted, who is let in, and especially who integrates well into a new developed nation, I mean. But that said, we shouldn't just accept up front that when people give religious motivations for particular action with regard to welcoming or not welcoming refugees, that those are genuinely religious, or that they are rooted in an authentic version of that religion. Because a lot of the time, economic motivations or other kinds of responses can be masked by religious motivations. So I think we need to be careful when we're analyzing the way people portray their motivations for their attitudes towards refugees. I think from the perspective of all three of the Abrahamic religions, Christianity, Islam, and Judaism, there's overwhelming support in those traditions for the welcome of strangers, especially strangers who are forcibly displaced. That's characterized in various different ways. But all those traditions are complex. And if people mine those religions for resources to restrict immigration, they are going to find pieces of evidence here and there to justify that kind of response as well.
Thanks, Barney. I want to turn to some of the political things that are raging around the world right now, and especially how this has been cast more as a political problem than any other respect. And Catherine, you might want to refer to the circumstances on the southern border of the United States, where, of course, there is a huge influx at the moment, as I understand it. This is something I've looked at in the past and been at the border and observed, but it sounds like all previous activity on the border has been rendered minor by what's going on now.
Yeah, certainly the numbers at the southern border are extremely high right now, and never been higher. So we have to that is certainly helping to fuel the politics around the upcoming election, and the politics locally in the state of Texas, and how what the governor is doing there, and what the governor how the governor has influenced places like Washington, D.C., and New York City, and Philadelphia, and Chicago, and Denver, with respect to sending people from the border up to those cities. So I can say, I mean, I totally agree that there is something extremely positive about refugees in host countries that tends to be masked by the politics currently in the US, certainly, but around the world, the politics that are created around this issue. But then what doesn't help is that numbers are at a record high at the southern US border. And most of the people coming in are, you know, claiming they need protection. So they're not coming in saying only that they're seeking a better economic, you know, set of opportunities, but they're seeking protection. And that is leading to conversations about how to restrict asylum in the US, how to change asylum. I don't think they'll be able to change asylum law because that means Congress has to be involved, and Congress is very politicized on one side or the other on the issue. But I think it's pressuring the Biden administration to change some rules that that would mean that there would be some restrictions in terms of how asylum is claimed and how quickly asylum claims are vetted. Currently in the US, if you come in, if you fly in and you have a tourist visa and you don't want to return because you fear persecution, you can apply for affirmative asylum. And the rates are much higher with affirmative asylum, the rates of receiving it, than if you come in through a border, like on foot, the southern border. There you have to go through a defensive asylum process, and that can take years. And up until very recently, the Biden administration was releasing most people into the U.S. who were saying that they feared return because due to persecution, and that would allow people to be in the U.S. for a number of years as their claim to legal relief gets vetted. But again, all of this now has become so much more political, not only in the US, but around the world, such that in the leading up to the primary election yesterday in the state of New Hampshire, I read that people in New Hampshire's biggest concern, largest concern right now is immigration. A state that doesn't receive many immigrants, doesn't host many immigrants, whether they're refugees or migrants of some other, you know, who came in another way. And that really, compared to 20 years ago when migration issues, refugee issues were usually ranked 5, 6, or 7 across the nation as being the most important issue, this really concerns me. So the governor of Texas has, there was just a few days ago, a litigation about removing barbed wire on top of areas, fences, and areas of demarcation at the border. The Biden administration argued that they wanted that barbed wire removed. The state of Texas argued against it. And there was a court that sided on the side of the federal government in this issue. But this will be relitigated now at a higher court level. The current governor of Texas has done many things, not only sending people from the border up to cities that are tend to be blue cities, but he's done other things in terms of putting demarcating in the middle of the Rio Grande, the river that separates much of the Texas border with Mexico. He put this demarcation in the middle, which is quite dangerous as people try to cross, and there have been more deaths as a result. So again, I don't think that at least in this hemisphere, you could get a more politicized moment for refugees, which really complicates not only their ability, you know, to do well in a host country, but complicates all of all of the processes that other people who are not already in host countries, right, are experiencing as they try to become resettled in a host country. So there's a lot of challenges here.
What you say about New Hampshire, Catherine, moves me to note that, and I would welcome everybody's comments on this briefly. Many of those people complaining by their very surnames, one knows, come from families who were immigrants to the United States. By their surnames, their history, their what we know about the evolution of these issues here. And many people seem to resent immigrants, for example, for seeking better economic circumstances. I can say, for one, quite openly that I would not exist as an American were it not for my parents coming here, in my father's case alone, and my mother's case with her family, to better their economic circumstances. And a very natural thing that we promote in other ways and say, come here and you'll be middle class and you'll succeed and you'll move up the ladder. So there is a vast puzzlement there, some would say hypocrisy, about people from immigrant families. And I suspect that might be the case in quite a few other countries too, perhaps including Canada, I don't know. So I don't know who wants to take hold of that particular part of the issue. Mike, maybe you do.
Yeah, well, I mean, I think what I would do, because I don't want to tread on any sensitive North American toes, as it were, on this, because obviously there's a lot more that's been running in the press and media about this situation in Texas. But it does strike me that there are distinct parallels, it's not quite the same, with the UK, with this obsession with boat people coming over. And particularly people, you know, being trafficked on lorries and other things to get into the UK. And this has been a really headline issue in the UK. And I would like to say a few words about it, if I may, because
please do.
It is fascinating, because this policy, which has been introduced by the, or has been attempted to be introduced by the Conservative government since 2022 under the rather controversial leadership of Boris Johnson, of shipping boat people, asylum seekers and so on, over to Rwanda, has been exceptionally controversial, because the idea is not so much to numerically ship lots of people over, but it has been to act as a deterrent to people taking risky pathways into the country. And, you know, to sort of ship them off instead. But of course, as you will all probably know, this policy was essentially overturned as being lawful by the Court of Appeal, firstly in the UK, and then it was overturned again, sort of positively overturned from my viewpoint, by the Supreme Court, which said, well, look, you can't do this because there are inadequacies in Rwanda in terms of the treatment of refugees, in terms of human rights and so on. There are defects in the asylum protocols Rwanda offers in terms of legal representation, in terms of issues about discrimination against certain minorities like Afghans and Syrians. And that also, that there was a policy in Rwanda of shipping people back to where they come from into very perilous conditions. And so this has proved very, very controversial. And I'm quite animated about this, because even in the press today, we have a situation where Rishi Sunak, despite the Lords wanting, you know, we have two chambers, obviously, one is the Commons, one's the Lords, and the Lords saying, look, they're not happy about approving what was agreed by Parliament, this bill which would enable the Rwanda situation. We're not happy until we're convinced that Rwanda will be able to process refugees appropriately and in a non-discriminatory way. But still today, the headlines in the paper, in the Times, you know, well, Rishi Sunak's pushing on regardless and is determined to have this in place in the spring. I think this is highly unlikely because of a variety of things. The issue, you know, to do with legal resistance, the question which is on even senior conservative minds, is it really a deterrent anyway, if that's the pathway you want to go, because there's no sign that it makes much difference to the volume of boat people coming in, taking that kind of parameter. And also, it seems to be incredibly poor, bringing the economics in, poor value for money, because already 240 million has been spent on this scheme going to Rwanda. And with you know, 50 million stashes of money to destined to follow. And so it really is a pretty, it's not unprecedented. There are some examples of this occurring in other societies, like Israel to Rwanda, for example. But none of these have proved particularly successful. But I think the main obstacle will be that just as you have the tensions between the Republicans and Democrats in the US, we have tensions about an election coming up in this particular year. Rishi Sunak is not the most popular person in the world, and most of the predictions are on a Labour victory. So much of this is going to be overturned anyway. So what we're having really, and this is where I'm going to end, is a situation where, as Catherine is saying, that the refugees are being dealt with as a political football. You know, it's a kind of political, position for Rishi Sunak. He wants to get re-elected. He knows that some people are exercised about this particular issue, I think wrongfully so. I totally agree with Rachel on that in terms of the benefit the refugees can bring. But, they're actually being dealt with in this kind of political mayhem, which is occurring in the UK, as it would seem in the US. And what we need to do is to get back to the humanitarian and economic issues. And this is where it really cuts to the chase, that it's in many people's interests that not that people put their lives at risk, that we create safe passageways to go from one country to another, and we recognise the skills that people can bring, or otherwise, you know, to the economy and the jobs they can fill. And we take a positive rather than a negative view of what refugees who risk their lives coming over on small boats and being stuck in the backs of lorries, you know, we need to look at this in a different kind of lens.
Good point, Mike. And I would ask Rachel and Barney both to take up this issue of who speaks credibly for the refugees, who has the standing in these very complex politicized moments to take the side of the refugees and the immigrants and not be a political pariah for doing so. Rachel?
Yes, I can speak to that, and maybe I'll come back to the earlier question as well. This is also a fascinating one. I mean, I would say, as someone who does research and clinical work in the field with asylum seekers and refugees and people without status, that it is these migrants themselves who are best positioned to speak for themselves, and that it's actually their voices that need to be amplified. Now, that's actually not easy, so I don't want to be overly utopian, because folks are precarious, and sticking their necks out politically is certainly not easy when they already feel in a position of threat. But I think actually we need to elevate and amplify the stories of people themselves. And that needs to be our roles as researchers and advocates and even political commentators, so that their actual narratives are heard. I would like to return to the point of the highly polarized discourse around refugees, because I actually think it's a fascinating area of sort of sociological and psychological study. How do our collective attitudes towards forcibly displaced people change and shift? And so firstly, I would say there, Didier Fassin in France has a very interesting account over the decades, how countries, nations' attitudes shift towards refugees according to labor needs in countries, mm-hmm. and that we have a much more receptive perspective and a hospitable perspective when there are higher labor needs and there's less scarcity. I think across perhaps it's not an exaggeration to say across the world, we can say at least in Canada and the United States, we're at this moment of dangerously heightened polarization, where citizens in our two countries, at least, are very frightened, are frightened by scarcity, are frightened by their grocery store bills, are frightened by the lack of housing. And I think this kind of fear, when we're in panic, we want to find a perpetrator. And so scapegoating becomes a psychological mechanism that can help us feel like we're in some kind of control. And so, of course, who is being scapegoated? Refugees and displaced people at the border. I think we need to have as a response, not just bombarding people with a message of needing to open their arms to refugees, but we do need, which I do think we need, but I think we need to actually make people feel heard and seen and respond to people's needs and help people understand it's not a zero-sum game. We don't have to take care of migrants versus taking care of citizens, that we're part of a global community and that ethics and morals have no borders. So in other words, empathy becomes dependent on privilege. And so we need to help folks who are feeling precarious and scared feel more secure.
Well put, Barney.
I completely agree with Rachel. I mean, I think fear is part of what drives this whole discussion at the moment. It's a very powerful political tool that governments can use to get themselves re-elected. And they want to scapegoat somebody who can't vote. So the migrants and the refugees are the obvious choice of a scapegoat. But I also completely agree with Mike that that doesn't actually make economic sense. If you talk to any economists who really know their stuff, they know that immigration is always good for the economy in the long run. It may, you know, in the first couple of years cause a deficit, but in the long run, it's always good for the economy. But that message hasn't really gotten through to the voting public because of this huge amount of fear, which is being capitalized on by the governments in place. And I think Rachel's also right that the way to combat that kind of fear and that kind of resistance is the people who are opposed to welcoming refugees, they don't have a human face to put to this problem. They just think there's this mass immigration problem. There's all these people over there who we need to keep out of our country or else our country is going to go to pot. But the moment you give them an individual human being with a face and with a story, the attitude changes. And so one of the ways that we can perhaps persuade the voting public, you know, statistics don't seem to be that persuasive because statistics don't get at the heart of the emotional motivations that are driving certain policies. I mean, we should certainly use the statistics for sure, but the human stories, the human faces, are a way to sort of break past some of that initial emotional resistance.
If I could just add, I totally agree. And I think that both the UN Agency for Refugees and now the UN Agency since 2016, the UN Agency for Migrants have been spending to get the word out, right? To get the individual faces, to do the kind of marketing around here are the people, right? And here are their experiences, to get more of that narrative out. Still much more needs to be done, I agree. But when I was at a meeting in 2017 with various people from both of the UN agencies where they're saying, you know, we really don't do enough of that, I realized, well, yeah, you know, we certainly don't. So I think I see them moving in that direction. I do want to say one thing. There is this political divide, and it's clear in all of our comments. There is something that has happened as a result of, you know, countries, governments, politicians casting refugees as good or evil. Mostly evil in some way, right? Some way of saying they're bad, despite the evidence, is that in most of the countries where the refugees have become so politicized, these countries have gone to temporary humanitarian visas of some sort to accommodate, right, the fact that there is not only many people who need protection, but there is a humanitarian emergency here that we have to respond to as a country, as a nation. So the way the U.S. has been doing it for the last number of years is allowing people, you know, doing what they call a credible fear interview at the border, and then, you know, that's not a it's not a merit base, it's not analyzing your merits for asylum, but it's, you know, if people say they're afraid, they let them stay in the U.S. and then they have how many years until their legal relief claim is adjudicated. That's one way to be humanitarian. Another way, formally, the U.S. now has a parole program with four countries, people from Cuba, from Venezuela, from Nicaragua, and Haiti, who they're trying to, this parole program says, if you have a sponsor in the U.S., you could come in to the U.S. with parole for 2 years. You can get a work permit immediately. You do not come up through the border. You fly into the U.S. So that sort of helps, you know, minimize the humanitarian concerns that many of us have as people try to make their way on foot, right, up to the U.S. And throughout the world, right, in Colombia in 2021, the president at that time announced a humanitarian visa, 10-year humanitarian visa for Venezuelans. At the time, the Duque administration thought there would be 1.5 million Venezuelans who would receive that, and close to 2.5 Venezuelans were eligible and received the humanitarian visa, permitting them to stay in the country for 10 years to work, to have their kids go to school. And throughout the world, we see the emergence since the civil unrest in Syria and the large-scale movement of Syrians and Afghans to Europe. We see more countries developing out these temporary humanitarian visas. Whether they're good or not, I mean, they're good in the short run for individual lives, right? But over the long run, it's basically kicking the football down the, you know, down the path, so to speak. Because what happens when you get to the end of that temporary period? Right. So so it doesn't give people a permanent claim to being in their host country by no means, and that has implications for their lives, for their children's lives. But there is a response. So I just want to make sure it's not as if countries are not responding in some way, but they're recognizing there's this huge political divide, and they're saying, okay, well, we can do this to, and it's not a substitution by no means, right, for what should be done.
Right. Thank you. Rachel, I'm going to ask you for a quick comment that you want to make, and then we need to go back to Mike Scott, because we have an almost unprecedented number of questions that I see coming in on the Q&A. We want to try to do that. We really only have about another half an hour to go. So, Rachel, the comment that you were inspired to make by what Catherine just said.
There are two things I want to say, but I'm not sure if I can be quick enough. So let me start with the first one, and then let me know. So in terms of these temporary visas, I mean, I agree with Catherine that these are really important mechanisms to try and protect people in these polarized times. At the same time, I just want to share with you some of the mental health research on only having temporary protection. There have been a number of studies done in Australia, and we recently wrote a meta-analysis, which is in peer review, comparing mental health status across visa statuses. And what seems to be very clear is that not having a full promise of protection, having temporary protection, especially when it comes with limited rights, for example, the right to reunite with family members who are in danger in a country of origin, that this precariousness really is the driver of mental health problems in the population. So people have much higher rates of mental disorders when they are rendered precarious. And there are a number of reasons for this. I mean, we know in the treatment of trauma, the first phase of treatment is security. So when people know, I'm safe temporarily, but I could be deported to death or torture or war in 2 years, this perpetuates PTSD and depression and anxiety in very, very serious ways. So yes, I think we need to look at these alternative models, but they also, some of them have a shadow side, depending on what, on how precarious people are and the threat for future insecurity. The other thing I will say, and we can save it for later, is I wanted to speak a little bit about Canada's shuttering of borders. And what the courts have said in terms of U.S. representing a safe third country. But perhaps we'll come back to that via the questions.
Okay, over to you, Mike. You have quite a few questions there.
Yes, I have. And I apologize to people that I might not be able to ask all the questions that have come in. I want to start with one from Opal Malai. And it talks about a country that you haven't mentioned so far. Opal says, I come from Thailand, and recently there have been a lot of pushback from Thai's government on Myanmar refugees, which is putting their lives at risk in Myanmar. As someone who wants to concentrate on the creation of refugees policy, what can you suggest the Thai government should do in order to protect those refugees, but also a policy that would not harm Thailand and its image in dealing with the refugees? Perhaps, Catherine, you might like to start with that one.
So there's a decades-long population of persons from Myanmar living in camps in Thailand. In this moment of millions of people, this group, this reality gets shorter shrift because it's maybe about 100,000 people from Myanmar who have been living in these camps in Thailand. And then, you know, with the newer, let's say in the last 10 years, you know, the newer movements of Rohingya and people from Myanmar, moving into Bangladesh, trying to get to Malaysia. Often, you know, very, very recently, it's people on boats from Bangladesh who have left Bangladesh and are trying to get into Indonesia. So this is a problem that isn't an issue that isn't going away, certainly. And it's just at a lower scale. And so it's not, I mean, most of us know about the situation, most of us in this space. But I think that, you know, the UN has limited resources and the Secretary General is always speaking about displacement, but often emphasizes the biggest displacements and the demands that, you know, what needs to be, how countries need to accommodate those displacements. So I don't know exactly what can happen. I don't know the Thai case that well, but I will say that every year there are additional people leaving Myanmar trying to get into Thailand. And sometimes the border is open, sometimes it's closed. But the issue is growing there, the issue of displacement, of how Thailand becomes a host country. Does it become a host country? I mean, currently, like I said, there are about 100,000 people living in camps. If you're living, if you're a refugee living in camps in a host country, often that means the host country is not fully hosting you and restricting your ability to live only in those places and then restricting your ability to work. Most refugees who live in camps around the world typically are not permitted by the country in which they're living to work. And the kids are not permitted to go to schools outside of the camp. So this is a growing issue. And Human Rights Watch did a recent report on the issue in Thailand. So I urge you to consult that report as well.
Thanks, Catherine. I think if this program's done anything, it's to raise the minority issue as well that we can forget, and I'm very, very happy that Opal, that you've actually raised that for us. Thank you very much indeed. I'm going to go on to some of the economic issues now. Josh Chandler says, increasing the population of working people in an economy can grow the economy. What steps should governments take to ensure that immigrants and refugees are able to contribute to the economy without risking the jobs of native workers? Can I just go on and say that Angela Preston also raises this issue? She says, in research by Cato, they list research which cites 3-4% decrease in wages for workers because of immigrants in the United States. While migrants may not intend to cause a crisis, lower wage workers see it as a crisis because of lost wages. How do you find a middle road? Those are the two questions that are coming through. I see Mike is nodding. So Mike, do you want to try the first one? And then,
Yeah, sure. Thanks very much, Mike. I do think that it goes back to a point that was raised earlier, that a lot of the questions about the political response to particular patterns of migration or dealing with refugees in terms of pushback relates to the economic climate of the country concerned. And I think here we need to note that over 70% of refugees are actually going to low to middle income countries, which don't have a lot of resources anyway. And this obviously is quite an issue. And this is why the UN's position is quite important, and the position of other governments in providing aid and supporting these countries is also significant. So we need to look at the kind of climate that these groups are going into. But one of the things that I find really extraordinary in the UK case, if I can speak on that as an example, is that we have many jobs in this country, including seasonal work, for example, which we should be welcoming refugees with open arms, I mean, even without skills, because there are lots of roles to fill. And I think the governments have tended to be a bit anal about the issue of skills and the skills coming in, because they're looking, you know, oh, these are shortages that we have in expertise, and therefore we might take a different view to people who are coming in, let's say in the UK, in terms of doctors, as opposed to other kinds of groups. But I think this is quite extraordinary, perhaps, in some of the more developed communities, the developed countries. So we need to sort of keep up the pressure, as it were, in terms of looking at the dynamics for particular countries and particular governments. And it's also about the leadership that those governments provide.
Rachel, do you want to say anything about this?
Well, this is at the heart of this complex, polarized issue. People's feeling that if refugees are deserving of a place, then it will come at the cost of citizen security and citizens' wages. I mean, I would want to look very closely at that Cato study and understand it, because that's not in line with research that I've read. So I would want to have a real critical appraisal of that particular study. And if wages are being brought down by the presence of newcomers well, maybe we have a problem with our wages system. Maybe we need an increase in the minimum wage across the board. So I think these are complex issues, but the questions really do get at the heart of people's fears about what it will mean to welcome the unknown other.
Yeah, and I will add that there was a National Academy of Science study done, published in 2016. It is about the economic integration of migrants and refugees in the United States. It is free. It is very long. And every economist who works at least slightly on this issue was part of this report. The overwhelming takeaway is that refugees and migrants add. And that for refugees, it does take more time. It takes them typically on average between 5 and 10 years, but then it's a net benefit because, you know, when refugees come into the U.S., they do receive some subsidies, limited subsidies, as I'm sure my friends in Canada and the U.K. could tell us. But nonetheless, it takes some time, but then it's a net positive benefit. So I agree. I'm not sure what Cato is referring to there. But I strongly urge anyone who's got interest in this question about how refugees and migrants and labor markets affect the wages of natives, that they look at the National Academy of Sciences study. You know, it sounds like such an easy question to answer, but in reality, if you're one of the social scientists trying to answer it, it isn't straightforward, and you'll see that in that report. Yeah.
Thank you for that. I'm going to go on to a question by Philip Sanderman, and perhaps Barney, you might like to take this one first. He says that. Is a master's student at Georgetown. My question: how important is the financial moral support for people in countries who are willing to host or take care of refugees? The hearts of so many people are big, but their financial possibilities are limited. In all these kind of debates, the kind of moral kind of question is hovering about. But for politics, what is the moral scene? Barney.
So how important is the moral and financial consideration? Is that the question?
Yeah, how important is the financial moral support for people in countries who are willing to host or take care of refugees?
Oh, I see, because of limited finance, even from people who are willing. Well, yeah. I mean, a lot of it comes down to your conception of our moral responsibilities to those who are different from us, right? Do we have a responsibility to embrace and welcome people from all over the world who look different to us, speak different languages? And it comes down to your conception of what humanity is. Is humanity just a bunch of individuals whose primary responsibility is just for their family? Or is our responsibility wider than that? Is humanity actually a common, a common brother and sisterhood, or just a we're all in this together kind of attitude? And I think from a religious point of view, there's a lot of support for the idea that we're all in this together. We're all a common humanity. We're all brothers and sisters together, and we all stand or fall together. And so we should all support one another. And as people have already said here, it's not a zero sum game. People often have a false economic model behind this, that if I give money to some refugee, that's less money than I have for myself. There's a limited amount of resources. And so if somebody else gets it, I have less. Whereas, of course, real economics knows that that's not how any of these things work, that it's possible to generate more resources, to generate more productivity, and it's possible to find solutions where everybody benefits, instead of some people benefiting at the expense of others. And so I'm not sure, I'm not sure I would be convinced that we should place an emphasis on the financial limitations of those who give support and help, because very often those limitations are more imagined than real, and creative solutions can often be found that just increase the benefit for everybody.
Isn't this to do with responsible leadership, Mike?
Well, definitely, actually. And I think, you know, one can talk about, you know, the refugee situation in a way that all refugees form a sort of homogeneous group. But in fact, there are differentials, and these differentials are quite revealing. I mean, if we take the issue about the Ukrainian refugees, which we haven't said a lot about so far, and as Catherine was saying, there are one of the very largest groups at the moment, and obviously politically very, very significant. The situation is that Ukrainians have been given a lot of protection, albeit temporary, and with all the significant consequences for their mental health and so on. But nonetheless, they've been given significant protection in the European Union, which unfortunately UK is no longer part of. But they've been given a lot of protection in terms of accommodation, medical care, employment, education. And then I look at the treatment of some other refugees who are not white and predominantly Christian, but, you know, and it seems, you know, like we almost have the equivalent of institutional racism, you know, in terms of the way in which these are regarded. And I think these differentials are quite important because they do reveal something about the kind of texture of society. But it's not just fear, but there is an undercurrent of discrimination in relation to different refugee groups. And I think this really needs to be plugged in, you know, wired in to some of the analysis. So it's not just the economics of the situation. It's not just humanitarianism, but there is a question of moral judgments which are formed on the basis of really quite flaky preoccupations to do with who is better, which group is better than another, you know. And this is not to take anything away from the plight of Ukrainian refugees, which has been extreme with, you know, millions of people going across the border to Poland and so on. But it's something that I would very much like to inject into the conversation.
Yeah, if I could just add that, you know, structural racism or discrimination may be part of it, but it's also what's part of it is that some nations, given where they are located geographically, given political relationships with other nations, right? Then there's a war, so their people would benefit. So there's some kind of historical political structure that facilitates, for example, the Ukrainians. UNHCR is certainly on the ground in Poland counting the numbers of Ukrainians coming in. But there are many Ukrainians who come in and don't stay under the auspices of UNHCR because as EU residents, they're able to go to Ireland. And Ireland, they may not even think about where Ireland is, but they show up in Ireland and you get processed immediately in the airport. It takes three hours. When you leave the airport, if you're Ukrainian, you have temporary work permit and you have a place to go. And that, you know, that's a way of accommodating Ukrainians let's say the Irish don't accommodate other groups in that same way, but part of it is comes out of this political structure of the EU and the buy-in of individual countries to be part of the EU. In the Venezuelan situation, you have Colombia taking in so many Venezuelans, but if we go back five decades, so many Colombians were taken in by Venezuela. So it's not the fear that Rachel, I know, has been talking about, which is real. There's less fear in that context because historically, when Colombians were being pushed out by the drug cartels, they found respite and life in Venezuela, and Venezuelans sort of embrace them. So they're not that different, maybe, in that context. There's maybe a little bit less fear. So it's not, you know, it's structural on a variety of different domains, right? But the political regime issues and the historical legacies also play out here.
Thanks for that. I hope that answered to an extent another question we had from Sharon Cheryl, which I can't go to now. I just want to go, but thank you, Sharon, for that question. But I hope Catherine's has answered it to an extent. Josh Chandler says, do you believe in holding asylum seekers whilst their claims are being processed? If so, where should asylum seekers be able to work whilst their claims are being processed? Should asylum seekers be held in hotels, barges, etc., if we do not have space in detention centres? Mike's puffing and panting there, Mike.
I can also speak to this too, because my research, previous research was
please,
on.
Okay, you start, please, Rachel.
Yeah. Yes. No, asylum seekers should never be held and should be allowed. This will make them sick in addition to violating their human rights. And so if we don't want asylum seekers to become a burden, we need to give them rights. They need to be able to live in the community. They need to be able to go to work. They need to have their own religious communities and integrate in their local communities, and go to school, etc. Kids need to have a life. So my previous work was on immigration detention of children, and we did a study in Canada, and I'm familiar with the international research, as well as my colleague's very large study. It is just so clear that putting people in detention makes them sick. We're also now doing work in, asylum seekers are now being held in hotels in Canada, which we are pleased the government is not leaving people on the streets, but often these settings become settings where people aren't permitted to integrate. For example, in Canada, many of the children, at least in Quebec, are not able to go to school for months and months and months, which impedes their integration. So there's no reason, legally, mental health-wise, from a health public health perspective, or from a human rights perspective, that people would not be able to live in the community while they're waiting for an asylum claim to be adjudicated.
Mike, yep. Very quickly, because we've got to close now. But...
yes, if I can translate the puffing and panting into words, what I would say is that again, looking at the UK, we find that over 62% of asylum seekers are waiting more than 6 months for a decision on their position. Some are waiting for years, actually. And we have cases, I note the reference to barges, we have reference of the Bibby Stockholm, you know, in Dorset, which holds 500 men. And, you know, it's very difficult environment, because not only are there suicide attempts, but there are also, you know, Legionella bacteria, which have caused major problems. This is a new initiative. This follows housing some of the asylum seekers in army barracks, disused army barracks and so on. And the asylum seekers in this position, and this is again the contrast with the way Ukrainians are treated, you know, in the current position, they are actually not just in this poor accommodation, but they can't draw on welfare benefits. They're not allowed to work, and they're just thoroughly disadvantaged in these situations. And there is a way in which we can look at the need for a greater level playing field for people who are asylum seekers across the piece. And so I really I pray for this situation. If I can say that with Barnabas with us as well, that I think that we really do need some radical change, and we need to treat everyone with due respect as a refugee and be very sensitive to some of the terrible consequences that they're facing in terms of schooling, in terms of poverty, in terms of other issues, particularly in the position where They're waiting for long periods for their asylum claims to be heard.
Thanks, Mike, for that. One last final word from Barnaby and Catherine. Have you got anything to add to that? I think it's a lovely, pertinent way to close. So thank you very much. Sandy, do you want to say anything?
Sure. Thank you, Mike. This has just been a wonderful discussion, and it does give some hope in difficult and tense times that people can reach beyond the immediate day-to-day issue and try to talk about this from a humanitarian perspective of kindness and dignity and humanity. I just think it's terribly important. Sometimes hard to see those solutions and those perspectives when, as Catherine and others point out, there's such tension on this issue from day to day. So thank you all. This is exactly what I would say Mike and I had in mind, a good way to open our new year of discussions. And we'll have 11 more this year and be up to 50 by the end of the year, I think. So this is a model. Thanks, of course, to Mike and his wife Maggie for all that they do to keep this series going and inspirational. Thanks to our colleagues at Georgetown University. Jack DeJoy, the president, is very supportive of this, and Tom Banchoff, our international dean, and really we've kept this going with the moral support of quite a few people at Georgetown and at Oxford for that matter. So thank you all for becoming part of this recent tradition. We're going to get everybody together one of these days who's ever participated in these conversations and have quite a hootenanny about the good that can be done.
I don't know if the government would allow us to do that, Sandy, but let's see. We will try. My thanks to Michael Sachs, Barnaby Aspey, Catherine Donato, and Rachel Connick. Thank the four of you very much. And of course, to Sandy for chairing the panel. The next free speech project at the Crossroads International Dialogues event, in association with the Future Humanities Project, will be on Wednesday, the 14th of February at 11 a.m. EST, 4 p.m. GMT, when we're going to try to discuss the impact of worldwide elections in 2024, when nearly half the world will be electing their respective governments. What's going to happen? What's it going to be like? What's the scenario going to be? So we're going to have a look at that. I also want to mention that another Zoom on Monday, the 29th of January, when Dr. Bob Miola from Loyola University in the US will be discussing Macbeth in our Cultural Encounters, Books That Have Made a Difference series. And that'll be at 11 a.m. EST and 4 p.m. GMT. And I hope you can tune into that on that date. So, hope so. My thanks also to the people at Blackfriars, John O'Connor, the Regent, Richard Finn, the director of the Lascaux Institute. And also my thanks, and I know Sandy's also, to John McCabe and other colleagues at Georgetown who have made this Zoom event happen. Thanks everyone who asked really great questions today. Thank you all very much. Sorry I couldn't ask all of them, but we tried to cover all of the areas. And so thank you all for attending today. I'm Michael Scott. I'm Fellow and Senior Dean at Blackfriars Hall, Oxford. You can follow me now on Facebook as Michael Kerr Scott or on LinkedIn as Professor Michael Scott. But for some reason, I'm no longer on X. Until next time, take care. Keep safe. Bye-bye. Thank you all very much. Bye-bye.